let me tell you a little bit about myself. Unlike all the top industry leaders, I'm very privileged to share stage with, so I'm thankful to Economic Times, and I'm really a researcher. And my journey into businesses has been after my return to India a few years back. So most of my education was in US, and I was essentially involved in two, three different streams. So you don't get somebody in artificial intelligence who started out as a biologist. Even within biology, I started out doing microbiology, then neurophysiology. I was recording currents from brain. And actually, the journey towards AI data science was very interesting, because whatever I was finding out, I couldn't do without processing data. So I ended up getting sort of a second component of my PhD while I was at UT Austin from NYU in mathematics, pure mathematics, doing computation. So my journey was sort of a reverse. So we have seen a lot of people who have come from physics or mathematics into biology. I went the other way around. And after that, I ended up doing sort of artificial intelligence and drug discovery for my last postdoc before moving to India. I'll tell you a little bit about my plans also, because what I realized, so I came back to India in a government setup, and I intend to leave it pretty soon. So I'm moving back to North America, but I realized there are so many needs of my home country, which I feel having my base in both the countries, whether I'm based in the US, doing things for their needs, and also coming back to India, setting up companies, whether they're based out of US or in India, and serving Indian needs, I think this will help me a lot more, and this will help the country a lot more. So I think I can also contribute a little bit to the billion people need. But the reason to do so, I realized, is some of the top innovation is still missing in India. But what we have been able to do is utilize power of citizen science. So there are a lot of talented engineers who are looking to do things and they don't get opportunity. So what India has provided me with is a chance to actually get a bunch of engineers to solve these problems. So one of the projects that I'm presenting to you, where I already got $22 million, so I've already raised money for this, is actually an epilepsy prediction thing, which I again did through citizen science. But I do want to sort of talk a little bit before I jump into it, that this is not the only thing. So we are working on healthcare. We are also working on some aspects of pollution and environment. We're also working on some aspects of finance, because while I was doing some basic statistical tool development, not even AI, deterministic statistical tools, we realized that we can actually beat state-of-the-art things in pairs trading. So we realized, okay, if I can do that, why can't I make more money than others and, you know, in Wall Street? So basically, I'm a researcher, and most of the times I'm looking for people who are from business end to take things forward. So let me get into this journey. Can we outpredict epilepsy? Now, I'm taking one disease as an example. We are actually working on a few other diseases as well. We are working on depression, very close to my heart. I actually lost my mom to it. So that's the biggest focus. But in addition to epilepsy, depression, alcoholism, we also work on Parkinson's. I'll today take you through the journey of epilepsy. What is epilepsy? You may think it happens to a very small bunch of population, but that's not the case. In fact, 40 million people is an underestimate. So put 40 million people, because that were recorded. If you go by sampling of the data, where people have actually done, it is 1% of any population they have measured. So that means you should be at around 70 million population, 70 million people. And the minimum industry estimate is $20 billion in terms of if you can predict and prevent any epilepsy. So this is, again, an underestimate based on the number of people. And the text I put, actually, this is not my original. I actually wanted to give a very broad picture. So what happens is economic costs, just because of the seizure, exceeds $1 billion in US, $15.5 billion in Europe. And if you think of India, right? This is, I've taken straight out of Wikipedia, so I'm not showing any of my bias. When it introduces epilepsy, it tells you, in India, epilepsy is estimated to result in cost of $1.7 billion or 0.5% of GDP. So imagine one neurological disorder, epilepsy, which is costing you 0.5% of GDP. So it's a very problematic thing. I don't want to take you through a lot of things that we have penned about various things. These are just blogs. I'm not taking you through research papers. But we have done the market research. We have done analysis of all existing tools. So this is just to provide that, OK, we haven't just focused on the research aspect. But what happens in epilepsy? To put it in very simple terms, epilepsy is synchronization of neurons, heavy synchronization. Most common form that you see, I understand this audience is not a biomedical audience, but most common form that you see is a patient lying on floor having motor seizure, right? So if the patient was operating car, heavy machinery, the person could be dead. So it's something very important, and that's just a manifestation. But some manifestations of epilepsy are even a kid not paying attention in class. It's silent epilepsy. So you're having synchronization, it's just that the synchronization hasn't traveled to motor cortex. So you don't see the kid lying on the floor and having seizures. And the teacher would simply say the kid is non-attentive, the kid is dumb, is not performing, but is actually having silent epilepsy, which gets less documented. So even the numbers really are an underestimate because they are not talking of that. So how do you measure epilepsy if you were to predict it? Current state is very bad. You're putting a bunch of electrodes on head, right? You can also put them with surgically inside. Those are intracranial. Intracranial, from the perspective of developing anything which can be a biomedical use, is by and large useless because you want to detect it without doing surgery. But even these many sensors will not be great, right? Imagine, nobody will be going around with a helmet wearing all these things all the time. So this is how you collect currently data. So what is a dream? I'll tell you the dream for which I'm actually registering a company in Toronto, been able to raise some money, hoping to raise more, is that we want to predict epileptic seizures days, and in the worst cases, hours in advance. What this will do, one is you can have an intervention. I'll talk of the intervention in a minute. But you can also take your regular medicine. Now, regular medicine will not help all. So why epilepsy is a very big problem. The best medicines for epilepsy, combined all, only can help 40% patients. 60% patients, epilepsy is intractable. They have to just manage their seizures. Can't do anything at this stage beyond that. But even the 40% patients who are taking medicines all the time, it's making them what you'll call hypoexcitable. It's making them lethargic. So if you can time their medicine, that is one thing that the prediction would do, but that is not the only thing. What I have a dream is, can you break synchronization? Now, let me tell you one story. It's not entirely scientific. When you think of epilepsy in India, what is a traditional knowledge, in at least by and large in North India, is that you make the person smell a shoe. Is it entirely pseudoscientific, or is there a basis? Actually, there is some basis. I'll obviously not recommend smelling shoe as a mechanism to break the seizure. There can be obviously far more advanced things, better things. But the reason is that the underlying neurological basis is that olfactory lobe bypasses thalamus and goes straight away to cortex, goes straight away to temporal lobe, and hence any strong stimulation can potentially block neuronal synchronization. So the patient is about to have a seizure, and you can give a strong stimulus, it can break it. I would like to warn, in contrast, you give a very strong visual stimulus, some images can in fact start. They can be a causal agent for even epilepsy. So not every strong stimulus works to prevent epilepsy. Strong olfactory stimuli can actually prevent epileptic seizures. So now the plan that we have, essentially, is to have an innocuous device, not 64 electrodes around the head, an innocuous device, just like a hearing aid, hidden under your hair, which can detect change in your brain waves much ahead in advance. Then a small stimulating device conducted, put in your nose under local anesthesia, not even global anesthesia, so I can activate your olfactory nerve so that I can break the synchronization. In the worst cases, where olfactory stimulation doesn't work, so you do PET MRI scan, find what is the frequent foci, focus or the foci of seizure, and implant an electrode there. So there'll be 10-20% patients where even this electrode implantation in nose will not work. There we'll have to specifically go in the brain region. That is the step, and the idea is you give them as near normal life. And it also works in a feedback manner that if they have less and less seizures, over time, their probability of getting next seizure decreases. So if you get one seizure, the probability of getting next seizure is high. Because there's a follow-up neuronal damage after seizure, there is increase in excitability, there is even neuronal birth. So I'll not go into the biology why if you have one seizure, the chances of you getting a seizure next day actually are higher. It's not that you had your seizure and you're done with. So over a period of time, if you're preventing seizures, it's going really well. But current status, right? Where are we at? And why, despite being a researcher somewhere in India, and when even I started this project when I was at Cold Spring Harbor, even though it's world rank one lab, in biomedical sciences. I was just working alone then, and now I'm working with a very small team. Why I've been able to beat others is we realized IBM has a product, Google has a product, Microsoft has a product. They're all focused on post-hoc prediction, and the prediction is not great. There are reasons for it also, right? Your AI might be great, but at the end of the day, if your data is not great, whether it's publicly available data sets or through collaborations with various hospitals and you have proprietary data set, it's not great. You can only predict post hoc. So the reason I've been successful is we've been able to outdo them. We are still, so I don't want to sell or oversell what we have achieved. That we are also right now just simply showing you, in addition to other things, that we can do post hoc prediction better than anyone else. And I'll show you exactly opposite of one thing we have done. So it's not the only way. So my philosophy is there are 1,000 ways to skin a cat, right? So what I'll do is I'll put one student or one researcher of mine to follow one approach, and I'll put other to follow exactly opposite. So I'm showing you today a generalized approach, which is patient non-specific. We've also done, so we've taken classical Boston Children's Hospital data set, which has 400 patients. We've also followed the approach of an AI which is constantly learning, which is very, very specific to individual patient. But now imagine time it takes. So if you are not connected to cloud server, the processing is not happening somewhere, and the patient is walking around, you may not be able to do much. If it is processing, it's taking too much data. If it can pick few signature elements, your AI, and it's patient non-specific, and can still work at 99% level of accuracy, won't it be great? Because you're traveling anywhere, your device is just sending the signal to your cell phone. The cell phone is signaling the thing to your nose implant to break the seizure. That'll be the greatest thing, right? So you want to build something which is patient independent, which works with every seizure. That is why we have developed this. We have also done opposite, where we have taken every single 400 patient data, which was from Boston Children's Hospital, and now we have around 8,000 patient data set, which I'm not showing you, where we tied up with a Finnish hospital, and we could get all their data on a proprietary basis. This is a public data set that we work with. So here, the basic idea is it'll work with anyone who's getting seizure. What we started out, let me see, do I want to take you through all these things? So basically, we took the raw data, we tried to figure out, I'll not get into the technicalities, how we went into it, and this is a non-seizure data. We basically identified what are the components. Right? It's not principal component analysis, but what are the components for a non-seizure state of brain, and what is the component for seizure state of the brain? Because end of the day, I want a simple small electrode. I want your cell phone to process all the epilepsy seizure things, right? So, and what we were able to do is identify different frequencies. So if you look at the non-seizure versus seizure, every time with every single patient, we are able to identify the difference. And what we are able to do is we are able to do several hours in advance. The best thing that IBM can do is 30 minutes in advance. We are at 8 hours. So end of the day, if you look at error accuracy, accuracy, specificity, and sensitivity, using any of the approaches, what I'm also trying to show you is I'm saying it doesn't really matter what AI approach we are using, right? Whether we're using deep neural networks, whether we're using convolutional neural networks, right? Whether we're using even simple logistic regression, ADA boost, or random forest, look at the numbers. We are talking in high 90s, right? The poorest of them is logistic regression, but it's really almost AI independent. This should be really big take home that it's not just how good your AI is. What you do with your data before you feed it into your algorithm makes a lot of difference. Here we said everyone is focused on patient specific. They're trying to say how good they are at, but they're doing post hoc. What good is a prediction if it tells you several hours after the patient already had a seizure that the patient was about to have a seizure and can only tell with 64 electrodes on the head? So that is where we've been able to outdo others by doing this. So I'll tell you the journey from here. The journey from here would be what we have done with mice, because the crazy thing I told you, can we break the seizures? We are at 99.8% rate of breaking seizures in mice using our implants. So this is mice, obviously this is not human, so I'm sure the journey will take me 3-4 years, FDA approvals in US or Canada to actually do it in humans. But that is the next step. But we are also doing several parallel efforts for epilepsy. And the parallel efforts come from my biology side. So along with a company called Cognoscete in Florida, which was founded by a very close friend of mine, Luis Scott, we were in the same lab during our PhD days in UT Austin. So we have developed few peptides which specifically target excitability in brain regions associated with epilepsy. So we are not only working with machine learning approaches, with AI approaches of this, we are also working with drugs to counter epilepsy. And surprisingly, we are also working with several things which India has to offer, Indian traditional medicine, which have not been well utilized. Most of the time it gets packaged in a very pseudoscientific manner. So what we are doing is Vidhania, Centella, Bacopa, which you may know things as Shatavari, Brahmi, and all in Ayurveda. These have all hyperactive effects. So they make the brain slightly what you call less active, puts you in slightly meditative state. And what we have been doing is testing of these in various epileptic models, and we realize that they are helpful. They're not as great as peptides, right? They're not as great as our modern medicines, but giving them generally without many side effects, without hardly any side effects, is very useful for epileptic patients. So this is where we are at, but now I'll tell you what we are doing with other aspects of AI. So I took you through an AI approach, which is radically different, right? Here I said that AI really, what we are using doesn't matter. It's just the pre-processing of data, why we are able to beat it. So this is the level of disclosure that I'm willing to give you on a product. Obviously, I can't go beyond that. But what are the other AI applications, which I think one, if I have to tell you, which I feel would genuinely transform the world, is our idea of making chemosimilars. If you ask what is the size of drug discovery, how much is the cost of medicine globally, it's far bigger. It's twice the size of Indian economy. It's currently at $8 trillion globally. If you talk of the cost of drug discovery globally, how much is medicine? Can you do better molecular docking? Let us say there are three, four steps of drug discovery. Failure at patient level, phase two, phase three clinical trials is obviously a huge cost. But even preclinical work adds up to a significant portion. What happens is something will be predicted to work well, but fails at toxicity level. Right? You spend quite a lot of money, you spend $1 billion, and it then gets stuck. Things goes to clinical trial, then it fails. There are a lot of issues. So can you do two, three things with AI? Number one, instead of running a random screen of molecules, let's say buying a library from MIT of 30,000 ion channel blockers for either epilepsy or Parkinson's, can I use AI to predict, okay, if BK channel is involved, which molecules will work? Better molecular docking. And can I limit the 30,000 to a sample of just 400? How much cost I'm reducing? Now, I'm not the only one. So if it seems like I'm proposing a radical idea, unfortunately, somebody has beaten me to the race in that particular aspect. I hope I'll do better than them. So there's already a company, Schrodinger, which is valued at $6 billion. One of my classmates is actually a co-founder of that. What they are doing is they don't own a single lab. They don't own a single drug discovery lab. They just do this prediction. They get a chemist to synthesize. They get a pharmacologist to test its activity. Then they get a toxicologist to test its toxicity. They get the synthesis done at a bigger scale, industrial scale. They have collaborated with various hospitals, and they have a drug out in market, and they have 18 in pipeline. So somebody without owning a single drug discovery lab has already gotten a compound out in market and are valued at $6 billion. It's a New York-based company. But what they are not doing, there's several other things that they haven't really touched yet, or nobody in AI and drug discovery field has touched, is can you predict toxicity? So it's basically taking the same molecular docking, but it's then applying to around 60,000 other compounds that you're not targeting. So that is where we are beating others, and where we are beating others, which obviously we're not there at the level of epilepsy where I'm showing the final product to you. It'll take me a year or two. But where we are beating others is something chemosimilars. We are generating chemicals that don't exist in real world, simply taking chemicals which are actually showing activity, and we are saying this compound will really work well for this medicine. If you think of a compound for any neuropsychiatric disorder, it takes 12 to 15 years to get in market. If you're thinking of a new antibiotic, if you think of actually a genuinely new skeletal structure, I'm not saying derivatives, it's been 40 years since we had a really new antibiotic. We've been modifying the same antibiotics to some extent or another, by and large to play the patent game, to make money, occasionally to even improve efficacy. But if you think of its journey, maybe it's 7 or 8 year journey. Can I reduce the journey to 1 year? So I think whatever we are applying our AI to can be actually not $1 billion, could even be one day a $1 trillion plus ball game, Might take me another 20, 30 years to get there. Hopefully, I'm alive till that stage. If I continue to live this unhealthy life, I may not. But anyway, so that is another aspect where we are applying AI. There are various other things. So we, even though I'm not an ecologist, in fact, it ended up being just a collaboration with now, who's just a good friend, used to be a girlfriend then. So with an ex-girlfriend, we were just, she's an ecologist, and she was saying that since you do machine learning really well, you do crazy things, can you actually apply it to some things in climate pattern changes? And we realized, I'll just give you one glimpse of, again, processing the data different. We said everyone throws away what is called noise, right? Noise means it has to be thrown away. But imagine if you have high-frequency stochastic fluctuations. Can two data sets have the same things? Not possible, right, if they're not causally connected. So people are throwing something so beautiful and throwing it away. And we are able to map which cities map well together, which are interconnected. So if you are lighting fire more in Punjab or more in UP, which will affect Delhi's pollution more, I can tell you that, which current statistical approaches will not be able to tell you with that much accuracy. So we started applying that to even climate change. And then I said the real money lies in stock market. So off late, I've been doing something in stock market too. So basically, I'm a researcher looking for people who are business minded to explore things, expand things. And I intend to have bases in two places, North America and India. That is sort of my journey. I hope to interact with you. I hope to get feedback during lunch or whatever time further. Thank you very much for your time.